Our reading for this Sunday in our gospel is really one text. It's Mark 13, 24 to 37. But in reading these texts, they really feel like two separate texts. So what we're going to do for our reading this Sunday is I'm going to read one, and we're going to talk about that for a little bit, and then we'll read the second one, and then we'll talk about that for a little bit. And as we go between these two, try to think about what is the big difference between these two stories, these two texts, and then the sermon will go on from there. So I'll begin with my usual greeting, one that Paul already offered you. Grace and peace to you from God, our Creator, and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Hear Mark 13, 24 through 30. It's on page 39 in your New Testament. But in those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light and the stars will be falling from heaven and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. And they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Hear this first part of our good news about the end of the world. This first passage of Mark is so specific, so sure, so knowledgeable about when and what is going to happen at the end of the world. They have inside information. They know how it's going to go down. Now, I'm a big planner. I like to plan for each contingency. I like to put the pieces together and kind of figure out, okay, what's the worst case scenario? Let's plan for that. I told you that I'm trying to be an optimist, but it doesn't always work out. I'm fairly realistic. And I try to build around that. But if somebody were to come up to me after all of my planning and say, what do you think is going to happen next? I'd say, I have absolutely no idea. Because nothing ever goes according to plan. But here, it's plain and simple. The sky will be darkened. Jesus will come on a cloud. The elect will gather. And we will know that it's soon, just like we know that summer is near. This generation will not pass away. You can almost hear the words coming, I guarantee it. You can take that blunt to the bank. It's so sure, so certain. There is some vagueness there, but really not. This generation will not pass away. The end is coming. Prepare yourselves. Very certain person. But hear Mark 13, 32 to 37, and listen to a somewhat different message. But about that day, or hour, no one knows. Neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, beware, beware. Keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It's like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeepers to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake. You do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn. Or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. This is the second part of our gospel, our good news for the day. Now, if I were to give an image to this part of the reading, it would be this. The other one, super certain, it's going to happen in this way, it's going to be this generation, there's going to be clouds falling, sun is darkened, and the other one's like, sometime it's going to happen. We don't know when. We don't know how. There's a journey coming, so stay awake. Not even the Son of God knows when it will happen. You can look to the fig tree, but we don't know. If these two stories were not back-to-back, you would think that this was an argument between two people about how the end would go down. We know when it's going to happen. No, you don't. We know how it's going to happen. No, you don't. We know who's the elector. No, you don't. But somehow, they're back to back. And we would say that it has to be one or the other. You can't have both. You can't have, it's going to be soon, and it, well, we have no idea. But what if you could? What if you could have both? What if he is actually describing two parts of the same event? One that has already happened, and one that's going to take a while. Consider some of the clues, and we have some really good clues. I'll admit it, I've skipped past most of these clues for most of my life, but unearthing them now, I felt a little bit like Indiana Jones. A really nerdy Indiana Jones that never leaves his office and chases after a toddler most days, but Indiana Jones nonetheless. Hear an odd phrase in verse 35. Therefore keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn. Isn't that word odd? Evening, midnight, cockcrow, dawn. Why not just say morning, afternoon, and evening? Isn't that how we would say it? When you get up in the morning, do you say, well, it was a little past cockcrow, but not quite to dawn yet? That's not how we generally speak. That's not how anyone generally speaks. It is so specific, so strange. And one commentary connects this to a grander story. And this is when I started digging up those clues. The commentary says that Mark divides the passion, the lead up to the crucifixion, into four parts. And he begins with the Last Supper, which Mark describes by saying, when it was evening, he came with the 12. Evening. So evening is the Last Supper. Chapter 14, verse 17. Then Mark leads into Jesus' prayer and betrayal. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy, because it was the middle of the night, or midnight. And once more, and that's in 14:40. And at the close of Jesus' trial, we all know about that famous rooster, the one that crowed those two times after Peter denied Jesus, it happened for the second time at the cockcrow. I always wonder what happened to that chicken. It's probably best not to know. And then, finally, Jesus is delivered to Pilate for trial as soon as it was morning. So you have evening, midnight, cockcrow, and dawn. That's how Mark divides up these sections, just like when we know the master will come in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn. What major life-changing, world-changing moment happened after all of these four things? The one that has already happened. Namely, Jesus returning from the dead, and even later, floating on a cloud. Even the end times language, the sun being blocked out, and the powers in heaven will be shaken. Doesn't that remind you of when at Jesus' death, the sun was blocked out, and a great earthquake shook the earth that caused John Wayne to say, truly this was the Son of God. I almost played the clip, but then it felt a little weird laughing at Jesus' crucifixion. So we just get John Wayne here in his image. Truly, this was the Son of God. If, in fact, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place, then doesn't the verse that says, then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven, sound like the gathering of Pentecost? When the winds blew and that fiery spirit came and took hold of them and changed the world forever, made us one church, gathered together in one body. That promised coming has happened. Of that much, Mark is trying to tell us. It's just remained buried in this story, in these hints, for so very long. But then we get to the nitty-gritty of reality. If the end has come, if the end is really here, shouldn't things end? If the kingdom has come, if the kingdom is fully present, then shouldn't things be better? We watch Ferguson and think, that's not how it's supposed to be. We watch the cold take hold and trap people and think, that's not how it's supposed to be. We watch sickness and disease and anger and quarreling. We think, that is not how it's supposed to be. And this is where the two stories of one come in. This is where the both and comes in. This is where the end has come and the end is still yet coming. Enters in. These are not two stories, but one story. The story of God's redemption of humanity. That includes each and every one of us. When we celebrate Christmas, we think we are simply retelling this story that we have heard so many times before of God's promised coming. When we celebrate Holy Week and Easter, we play out the greatest story ever told, like a movie unrolling, stuck on the screen, trapped. But each time we hear these stories, each time we share these stories, each time we enter these seasons, we aren't telling these stories, we are living these stories. God is coming again for us on Christmas Day. God is dying again for us on Good Friday. God is rising again for us on Easter. The end comes again and again and again because we need it to. We need to start over. We need to move on. We need to believe those words again. Jesus is coming. The season of Advent is about taking time to once again live this story. That final end will one day come. And until that day, we must fight with everything we have to make God's work minimal. We want those angels to return, gathering from the four winds, only to screech to a halt and say, oh, you've already done it all. Never mind, good job. That is our goal. The world is not perfect because that is our job. The world is not ended because we have work to do. The story isn't completely written because we are still writing it. In this Advent season, think about what needs to end for you and what must begin. Think about the God that is coming to lift up your life and how you can help with the living. Think about the change that is coming on Christmas morning and how we can, through this Advent season, prepare for that change to this world. May this season of Advent, this season of waiting, be more than a story for you. May it become the new end and the new beginning that God has prepared for you. Amen.